If you need to connect two or more wires together to extend them or combine them or whatever, there are several different ways to do it. Some are good, some are bad, and teaching you about the different ways to splice wire is exactly what I'm going to cover today in lesson number 10 of this wire terminals playlist. My name is Nate, and welcome to the EXPLORIST Life Mobile, Marine, and Off-Grid Electrical Academy. Now, I've already talked about how to cut wire, how to strip wire, and how to use heat shrink back in lessons 4.2 to 4.4 of this academy. So in this video, I'm just going to assume you already know how to do all that and just talk about the splicing part of this process. Now, instead of just showing you my single preferred way of splicing wire, I'm going to show you some splicing methods that we've seen or done in the past and then rank them on how good they are, in my opinion. Let's get started. Lever nuts. If you have two or more wires, 10 gauge or smaller, that you need to join together, lever nuts are a great option, and I use them all the time. They have a little lever on the front that flips up so you can put the wire into place and then locks down to keep the wire in place. And if you need to redo the connection, you can just lift the lever back up, release the wire, and try again. Now, they may not seem that secure at first glance, but we've done some pretty extensive testing on them here at our shop, and they are pretty impressive. They don't really come in options any larger than 10 gauge, and they also aren't watertight, so they might not be appropriate for wet locations. I give lever nuts a 10 out of 10 rating. Anytime it's appropriate to use them, I'm always going to opt for them due to their ease of use, how easy they are to inspect, and how solid of a connection they make. Butt splice connectors. Butt splice crimp connectors allow us to just put a wire in one side, crimp it in place with insulated terminal crimpers, and then put the other wire in the opposite side and then crimp that one in place. And now you've got a very secure electrical connection. Butt splice connectors, they come in two versions, insulated and non-insulated, and these are the insulated versions, and they have actually a bit of heat shrink on the insulation, so when you hit this with a heat gun, all of this seals up nice and tight for a watertight connection. The only downside, realistically, to this connection is that it can't really be undone without just cutting the splice off and redoing it. But a removable, splice isn't always desired, so pick your poison there. Now, if you have two wires of the same size and need a permanent splice, it's hard to beat a butt splice connector with adhesive line heat shrink pre-attached to it. And just like the lever nuts, I also give butt splice connectors a 10 out of 10 rating. Terminal blocks. Now, we use terminal blocks when we need to join two or more wires together at 10 gauge or larger. And you can actually see these in use in our OEM RV splice boxes where we may need to connect multiple 10 gauge or multiple 6 gauge wires to OEM 10 and 6 gauge wires that's installed from the factory. A terminal block is a screw terminal connection and works with a range of sizes and can be color-coded depending on its use, and these terminal blocks are connected electrically top to bottom, and you can also join multiple terminal blocks together electrically with a terminal block jumper, which you can see in use in our dual multi-plus splitter box. Now, terminal blocks are designed to be installed on a DIN rail, and the DIN rail needs to be mounted on the inside of a DIN rail junction box, which makes the connection somewhat costly and pretty bulky. Now, I rate these at a 9 out of 10. I'm docking a point because they're just kind of bulky, but their electrical connection methods, as well as their flexibility of installation, simply can't be beat. Mesh splice. A mesh splice is a way to splice two or more wires just by sort of meshing the wire strands together, then twisting them into place, and then covering them with heat shrink. Now, there is nothing physically holding the connection together except for the friction of the wire's strands, which makes this not a particularly strong connection. Now, although this does work in a pinch, it's not really strong enough for me to be inherently comfortable with it and should be a last resort. If you do find yourself where this is the best option, I definitely recommend zip tying each side of the splice to something solid so nothing is pulling on the connection. I rate this one a 3 out of 10. Soldered connection. To make the mesh splice significantly stronger, you could solder that mesh splice connection, and that would pretty much remove all doubt on if the connection would pull apart or not. Soldering, and therefore superheating the wire, can make a weak point where the wire goes from hot to cold and is prone to work hardening, becoming brittle, and breaking. This is why the ABYC specifically forbids or restricts the use of soldered-only connections. The downsides of soldering with work hardening, plus the fact that it takes a bit of practice to get good at, puts this connection at a 4 out of 10 for me. Solder seal. Solder seal is a specific brand or type of butt splice connector that is essentially a piece of adhesive line heat shrink tubing that has a little band of solder on the inside. Now, in theory, we should be able to put this over a meshed connection, heat the connection, and the heat shrink will shrink and the solder will melt, fusing the wires together. So I've really wanted to like these, and I've used them a lot in the past, but I don't have any to demo today because I think I threw them away. But I've struggled to get the connection to work without a stray wire strand just stabbing through the side of the insulation whenever I'm shrinking the heat shrink, you know, burning myself or just simply keeping the connection together when working in a really tight space. I'm actually going to rate solder seals as 4 out of 10, the same as regular soldered connections, and I think that these would still be forbidden by the ABYC since the solder is the only thing holding the wires together, but these are basically the same form factor as a crimp butt splice connector, so if a solder seal connection would work, you may as well just use a butt splice crimp connector and remove all doubt. Wire nuts. Wire nuts have been the industry standard for residential wiring here in the USA for decades, and they work fine for that. They simply twist onto the ends of stripped wire, joining and protecting the connection. In mobile and marine applications, the vibrations of the engine running can, over time, loosen the wire nut and create a loose connection. This is so much of a hazard that the ABYC specifically forbids their use in marine-based electrical systems. Now, I have two ratings here, depending on their use case. For residential applications, I give these a 6 out of 10. They're basically doing the same thing as a lever nut, but a lever nut is easier to use, easier to inspect, and a nicer form factor, in my opinion. For mobile or marine applications, 0 out of 10, since they're specifically forbidden with no exceptions by the ABYC. Twist, tape, and pray. We see this one a lot when we're fixing broken systems at various events we go to throughout the year, and you'll just, you know, strip back some wire, twist it all together, and then wrap it up with some painter's tape and call it a day. I'm not judging you. Okay, maybe I'm judging a little bit, but yeah, we've seen this. Twist, tape, and pray, the downsides. Basically everything. It's not a solid electrical connection, and you can expect it to come loose pretty quickly. It doesn't show good workmanship. The only time I'm going to use something like this is if I'm just like tabletop testing some 12-volt circuits just to see if something will work or not, but I would never, ever, ever use this in a permanent situation. Negative 3 out of 10. It's easy, and that's literally its only positive attribute. Lever nuts, butt splice connectors, and terminal blocks are pretty much my go-tos, and I really don't use anything else. For me, if I'm having to splice larger wire or do something that falls outside of what can be achieved with those three options, something's normally gone wrong, and I want to have to take a step back and truly ask myself if what I'm doing is actually good system design and potentially rework that system design as necessary so I'm not cutting any corners. Now, we are going to be splicing a lot of wires throughout the rest of this academy, so be sure to bookmark this lesson for future reference and come back to it if you need a refresher, because going forward, I'm just going to assume that you now know how to splice wires. Next up, I'm going to teach you everything that you need to know about wire management. Click up here to watch, and I'll see you over there.